We're going to take a look at the dynamic CMOS logic family. Dynamic CMOS preserves the advantages of normal CMOS while addressing its problems. So this is the dynamic CMOS inverter. It consists of three transistors. There's a single NMOS transistor M1, and then there are two transistors, one NMOS and one PMOS, and an MP. These are called the clock transistors because their gates are fed by a clock signal. So the input is given to transistor M1, and the output is taken at the drain of transistor M1, or more specifically at the drain of the transistor MP. Now we have a clock signal in this network, so we have to consider what's happening to the network in the two phases of the clock. The clock is a periodic square wave. It's going to have a zero phase and a one phase. What the clock is going to do is it's going to reconfigure the network in its two phases to act very differently. So we have to look at the two phases of the clock independently and figure out what's happening at the output. We are also looking at two entire periods in which the input is either one or zero. So we are considering all the cases for this network. We are considering when the clock is zero and the input is one, when the clock is zero and the input is zero, when the clock is one and the input is one, when the clock is one and the input is zero. And let's figure out what's happening. So first of all, when the clock is zero, in this case, the PMOS transistor MP is going to be on, and the NMOS transistor MN is going to be off. Now the output node is going to have a capacitance, CL. Whether or not it is loaded by an external gate, there will be a value of parasitic capacitance at the output node. Notice that the transistors MP and MN can never be on together because they are fed the same signal to their gates. So in the zero phase, the transistor MP is on because the input is zero. Now, the transistor MN is off, so is transistor M1 on or off? And the answer is we don't actually care. We don't actually care at all whether transistor M1 is on or off. In this case, it will be on because input is equal to 1. But in all cases, because the path to ground has been cut off by transistor MN, we don't actually care about what's happening in transistor M1. And so the output in this case will always be VDD because the PMOS transistor MP is providing a path to supply. Now this is going to happen regardless of the value of input voltage, and therefore it will be 1 in both zero cases of the clock. So whenever we have a zero phase for the clock, the output will be VDD, and therefore the output does not carry a logic value. There's no function being performed here. In fact, we call this phase the pre-charge phase because we always charge the output node up to VDD, and we are pre-charging it ahead of the upcoming phase, which is the one phase of the clock. So let's look at what's happening in the one phase of the clock. So in this one phase of the clock, the PMOS transistor MP is going to be cut off, and the NMOS transistor MN is going to be on. So the transistor MN is on. Now, with the input equal to 1, the transistor M1 is also on, and therefore there is a path from the output node and the capacitor CL down to ground. And therefore, the output is going to discharge and will give us an output value of 0, or a 0 volt, basically. Now, in the following pre-charge phase, again, MP will turn on and MN will turn off, and we will recharge the output node back up to VDD, and therefore we are ready with a VDD at the beginning of the upcoming one phase of the clock. In the next one phase of the clock, the output node will, the transistor MN will be on, the transistor MP will be off, but the transistor M1 will be off because its gate input is equal to 0, because the input is equal to 0 in this phase. And therefore, M1 will be off. So what's happening at the output node in this case? What's happening is it's observing an open circuit at the top due to the transistor MP being cut off, and an open circuit towards the bottom because transistor M1 is also cut off. So what's the output value here? The output value is VDD. We are going to preserve the VDD at the output value. But this is preserved in a high impedance node. And so if we look here, we will find that node out is a high impedance node. It is a floating node. It is preserving the value of VDD on the capacitor because the charge has nowhere to go. But recall what we did in the previous video. The VDD on the output node here is very different from the VDD we are used to because it's very sensitive to noise. So if you look at the one phase of the clock, what's happening? When the input is equal to 1, the output is equal to 0. When the input is equal to 0, the output is equal to 1. So in the one phase of the clock, we say that we are evaluating the logic equation. And so output is equal to input bar, but this is only true in the evaluate phase. In the pre-charge phase, the output is always equal to VDD. Why is the pre-charge phase necessary? Because if we had discharged the output node as we did in this case, the only way we can recharge the output node back up to VDD again is by providing a path to supply through MP, which we did here in this pre-charge phase. Why would we have to pre-charge the node ahead of evaluate? Because if we are going to evaluate one, then the only way to be able to evaluate one is to come into the evaluate phase with a charge of VDD, because the one is evaluated through a high impedance node. We have no possibility of having a path up to supply during the evaluate phase because MP is always cut off in the evaluate phase. And so the only way to have a one during the evaluate phase is to have had it charge up during the pre-charge phase. So why is this good? Why is this logic family good? Let's look at what's happening here. The output high and the output low are both the ideal value. The output high is equal to VDD. It's a little bit questionable because it's a high impedance node, but it's still VDD. The output low is equal to 0 volt. If you look at the steady state in all cases, whether we are pre-charging, whether we are evaluating a zero, or whether we are evaluating a one, you will find that the steady state current is equal to 0 in all cases. In this case, we will discharge, and in the steady state, the capacitor will be open circuit. In this case, everything is an open circuit. In this case, we will charge, and eventually the capacitor is also going to be an open circuit. So we have 0 steady state current, right? And if we look at the VTC, we will find that it is it has a very narrow transition region, which means that we have preserved the advantages of normal CMOS. But if you look at the architecture of this gate, you will find that we have also addressed the disadvantages of normal CMOS. Because the general architecture of this gate is to have the PDN, the pull-down network, the same PDN from CMOS, sandwiched in the middle between two transistors, NN and MP. These are clock transistors, and they are always fed the same clock signal. The logic inputs are given to the PDN, and the output is evaluated at the drain of the transistor MP. In the zero phase of the clock, the output node will always be charged up to VDD. In the evaluate phase of the clock, which is the one phase of the clock, either there will be a path down to ground through the PDN, and there is always a path down through MN, because during the one phase of the clock, MN is on, in which case we will evaluate zero, or there will be no path down through the PDN, which is the ones in the truth table, in which case the output CL will have a value of VDD, albeit in a high impedance state. Now, if you look at the inputs that are fed here, let's look at for example, a NAND gate, a two-input NAND gate in dynamic CMOS is going to look like this. And so if you look at the inputs are fed only to one transistor, so only to a single NMOS transistor. In static CMOS, we had to feed the input to two transistor gates. We had to feed it to an NMOS transistor gate and to a PMOS transistor gate. This meant that our external loading was worse than double because we have to size the PMOS larger than NMOS. Here we are only feeding it to an NMOS gate. Even the intrinsic delay in CMOS is going to be worse than in its dynamic counterpart because in CMOS we have a pull-up network and a pull-down network. And the output node is loaded by the capacitance of both the put-up network and the pull-down network, with dire possibilities for the loading of the pull-up network because of the sizing of PMOS. Whereas here we only have loading from the pre-charged PMOS and the pull-down network. Another really important point is that in static CMOS, we were really worried about short circuit current. And the reason for that is that the input was provided to both the NMOS and the PMOS. So with the input having a certain slope, with the input having a certain slope, there was a range where both the NMOS and the PMOS were on. And even worse, as the output dropped slowly, there was a range where both NMOS and PMOS were saturated. This range allowed a short circuit current to flow between the output, between the supply and ground, not participating at all in the charging or discharging of the output node capacitor, which increased delay even further. In dynamic CMOS, on the other hand, we do not have an input that is provided to two transistors. The input is provided only to the NMOS and the PDN. The PMOS here is fed a clock signal. A clock signal can be much more well managed than a logic input, allowing the PMOS to be turned off much faster during the evaluate phase and preventing the creation of a short circuit path between supply and ground. So if you look again at the graph here, there are actually three possible states for the output node out. The output node out could be pre-charging, it could be evaluating a zero, or it could be evaluating a one. So the only case where we are actually seeing a weird node, a node in a state that we have not seen before, is when we are evaluating a one. When we are evaluating a VDD, the output node is high impedance, but when we are pre-charging or evaluating a zero, there is a path either to VDD through the MPPMOS or to ground through the PDN and MN. It is only while evaluating one that we are seeing this weirdness, which we have to deal with because we haven't seen before.